Welcome back to YouTube classes. Dear students, in last class we have discussed about torque acting on a current carrying coil in uniform magnetic field. That means turning effect, rotating effect acting on a current carrying coil when it is placed in magnetic field. We have discussed about that in last class. Of course, we have derived the expression also. What is that means? Tau equal to capital M also, no problem. M being sine theta. Okay, we have derived. In which M is nothing but magnetic dipole moment. Magnetic moment simply it is called magnetic moment. B is nothing but magnetic field. Here theta is nothing but that is the angle between magnetic field and a magnetic dipole moment. Is it? Now this thing we have studied in our previous class. Now presently the topic is moving coil galvanometer. Here moving coil galvanometer. Okay, the topic is there. Sir, galvanometer in previous class only, in current electricity chapter, while we are discussed about Wheatstone bridge, there we have used the galvanometer. At that time I have told galvanometer is an electrical device which is used to measure the small currents. To measure the small currents, the device which we can use, that is said to be here galvanometer. Right? Now here galvanometer means the device which is used to measure the small currents. Of course, moving coil galvanometer. About this one, we have to study. Now to study this one, okay, what we are going to take here means, of course, we are going to take, you just see, once again I am going to take the set of bar magnets I am going to take. Now this is nothing but north pole, and this one is nothing but what I have to make means south pole, of course, I am taking. Okay, in between north and south poles, here I am going to take one rectangular current carrying coil, of course, I am going to take. Now this rectangular, that means how many number of turns are there, means some n number of turns are there. And this coil, some n number of turns are there. Of course, this coil means number of turns wounded on a insulating material. Insulating material is which is non-conducting. On a non-conducting material, some number of copper wire turns are winded like this means, then the alignment is said to be a coil. Now this coil is hanged in between two poles, north and south poles, okay, by means of a arm. See, this is one of the wire, right? This wire is connected at this point. Now this is nothing but here torsional head point, okay, by means of a wire. The name of the wire is nothing but phosphorus bronze wire. Phosphorus bronze, okay, wire is nothing but by means of this phosphorus bronze wire. Now this coil, now this is completely is nothing but coil. This coil, rectangular coil, how many number of turns are there, means some n number of turns are there on this coil, right? This coil is handled like this. Now here other end of the coil, that means from this torsional head point to, okay, this one is going to connect one of the terminal which is nothing but T2, and this one is nothing but lower end of the wire is connected to the, okay, one of the terminal which is nothing but T1. Now from T1 there are some another connections will be there. Finally it is going to reach the, it is going to connect to the battery supply. That means from battery supply somewhere here connected, okay, from this battery connection there are current is flows, okay, from like this some battery connection will be there. Of course you just to take, okay, like this battery connection will be there. From here, from battery positive to, current will be flows in the coil, okay, like this, and finally current will be reached to, okay, through the terminal to battery negative like this. That means from these two terminals, T1 and T2 terminals, current is flows, okay, into the coil. Now this is a current carrying rectangular coil. When a current carrying rectangular coil has placed inside a magnetic field, that means in between north and south poles, whatever the magnetic field is there, now that magnetic field, how we can take means? We can take it as like this. Now this is the magnetic field in between. Now this is the magnetic field in between this magnetic field, north and south field, south poles, whatever the magnetic field. Magnetic field direction is from north to south pole we have to take. Now in between these two poles, whatever the field is there, within this magnetic field, whatever the field B, magnetic field is there, within this field, here we have placed one current carrying coil rectangular coil. Immediately, whenever the current carrying coil has placed inside a magnetic field, then that coil is undergoes, okay, rotating effect. Rotating effect. That means the coil is experiences the torque. Experiences the torque. Torque, when it is going to experience the torque, then what happens means, okay, see, what is the theta? Theta is nothing but angle between the, okay, magnetic moment and magnetic field. Magnetic dipole moment and magnetic field in between, whatever the angle is there, that angle is nothing but theta. Now suppose, whenever the current flowing through this coil is, increases magnetic, that means, angle between the, that means, deflection of this coil also increases or decreases. It may happen. It may happen. Is it? That means initially, okay, how are there these two means? For example, if you just see magnetic dipole moment of this coil is leaning towards your direction. Magnetic field direction is okay, like this is there. Magnetic dipole moment direction is towards you is. Now in that case, what is the angle between magnetic field and magnetic dipole moment is nothing but 90 degree. Whenever the magnetic, okay, angle between the magnetic field and magnetic dipole moment is 90 degree, then torque will become maximum, that is equivalent to B. Equivalent to B. That means whenever, suppose if the current has changed through this coil, whenever the current has changed this through this coil, then the torque experienced by the coil also changes. Initially, okay, torque, angle between, torque is maximum. Why? Because angle between magnetic field and magnetic dipole moment is 90 degree. Suppose, whenever the coil has rotated, okay, like this. Actually, coil is being like this. So, I will give one example, please. Right, now just you take it, this is the point. Whenever the current has changed, actually it is being like this coil. Now magnetic dipole moment of this coil is perpendicular to, okay, plane. Now in the case, whenever the current has changed, then the coil becomes like this. In the case, we just see, okay, initially angle between the magnetic field and the magnetic dipole moment is nothing but 90 degrees here. Whenever the current has changed in the coil, so it is going to rotate like this. When it is going to rotate like this, in the case, the angle between the magnetic field and our dipole moment has decreased. When the angle between the magnetic moment and the magnetic field has decreased, immediately what happens means torque value will decrease. Torque value will decrease means obviously the current which torque value is decreases means, that means deflection value is, that means what happened means in this case, the current which we have allowed to fall in this, allowed to, okay, flowing in this coil, okay, it is difficult to measure accurately. For example, suppose if you give 1 ampere current, for 1 ampere current, if the deflection is nothing but 10 degrees, for 2 amperes, current is doubled, means, okay, here current, when the current flowing through the coil has doubled, the angle also must be doubled, that means 20 degree, right? When you give the current through the coil is 3 ampere, right, this must be, okay, 3 times, that means 30 degree. That means if the angle for 1 degree, okay, it has rotated through 10 degree, for 1 ampere it is rotated some
10 degree for 2 amperes, 20 degree for 3 amperes, 30 degree. If it is rotates like this, means that the meter is set to be here perfect meter. But here what happening is, whenever the current has changing, flow of current has changed in the coil. Now in the case, okay, for 1 ampere, suppose 1 ampere, okay, 10 degree, for 2 amperes, 15 degree, okay, for 3 amperes, okay, 22 degree, if it is, okay, rotated, if the coil has rotating like this, means then what we can say, the meter is not suitable for this. Why it is not suitable? Means because of whenever the coil is rotating, when you are supplying the current, for whatever you are giving the current, okay, the coil, magnetic dipole momentum of the coil and magnetic field, always they must be perpendicular to each other. Then only what you can see means, then only you can get here, okay, constant torque. That means to get to the constant torque for whatever the rotation of the coil, right? If the coil has been like this, or like this, or like this, or like this, for whatever rotation of the coil, right? Magnetic dipole moment and magnetic field, between these two angle must be 90 degree. Then only what we can get means, we can get here constant torque. So here these two poles, whatever the poles we are taking, north and south poles, power magnet poles we are taking, these poles are not going to provide the what type of magnetic field? Constant magnetic field. So these poles are not suitable for, okay, producing the constant, that means constant torque when the coil is rotating. Now for this purpose, by replacing these two poles, here I am going to take another two poles. Now what type of poles? Means harsh issue flow. See, what type of magnetic poles? Means concave shaped poles, or concave. See, concave shaped poles. Concave, okay, shaped poles. Now this is nothing but north and this is nothing but south. If you take concave shaped poles, in that case what it means, okay, these poles are almost to produce the, okay, what type of field means, you just see. Now north to south, here field is like this. Now in another magnetic field line, okay, like this. In case, okay, another magnetic field like this, here like this will be there. That means whenever the coil has turning almost to, okay, field and this one, both are perpendicular. Just to see here, now this is nothing but coil. Now coil and magnetic field both are in same direction. If you take like this one, if the coil has, okay, turned like this or like this, see in this case, okay, you just see this line and this line, almost these lines, these two lines are, okay, perpendicular to the coil. Now if you take these two lines, this last line here and this line, see these two lines almost they were, okay, perpendicular. That means this magnetic line and the plane of the coil, both are perpendicular. Plane of the coil and the magnetic field both are perpendicular always, then the torque experienced by the coil is constant here, right? That means this plane shape or bar magnets, north and south poles of bar magnets, when the coil has rotating in between these two bar magnets, okay, in that case torque experienced by the coil is keep on changing. But our aim is nothing but torque experienced by the coil, it must be constant. If you replace these two poles, okay, by some concave shaped poles, in that case almost, that means nearly they produce the, nearly, in this case nearly plane of the coil, that means magnetic dipole momentum of the plane of the coil and magnetic field, nearly always they keep on, how they were being, they were being the perpendicular to each other or normal to each other. Then the normal, then torque is nothing but always MD.
Like sine 90 degree always normal means sine 90 degree always. It is 90 degree means sine 90 value is 1. So always start we have to get 90.
So here this one is not at all giving the. That means these two margin and the coil has rotating in between the two poles. Okay, torque is keep on changing.
Here nearly torque is equal, not exact. But by doing one simple thing here, okay, we are going to make magnetic dipole moment and the plane of the coil both are exactly perpendicular to each other. That means what we have to do here means in between, okay, these two plane. Concave, okay, north and south poles if you take, okay, in between these two, if you just take, you just take one iron material. Iron material is best example, now this is completely iron material. Iron material is best example, in this one, soft iron, right, in between this north and south poles, you just keep the what type of material is, the material is nothing but soft iron. Whenever you place the soft iron, in that case soft iron, what is that? That is a ferromagnetic material. Ferromagnetic material, right, whose permeability is very very high. Permeability is nothing but mu. Mu value is very very high. That means permeability is very much greater for ferromagnetic material. That means in a magnetic field, if you place a ferromagnetic material, that means easily that ferromagnetic material will become a magnet. Is it? That means that ferromagnetic material is strongly magnetized whenever it placed in a magnet. That means in between north and south poles, here magnetic field is there. Within this magnetic field, if you place a soft iron, that means ferromagnetic material, this ferromagnetic material will become magnetized. That means magnetic field lines which are coming from north to south. Okay, these magnetic field lines are easily passes, okay, through this material. Like this magnetic field lines are easily process through this. Right here, another magnetic field line is, okay, easily it can process like this. Right here, another one, easily it can process like this. Right here also, one more magnetic field line, easily it can process like this. Right here, one more I am taking. Now this is nothing but another magnetic field. This another magnetic field, easily, okay, they can process like this. Right, now see, north to south pole, whatever the lines are coming, these lines are easily passing through the, okay, this ferromagnetic material or soft. Now in that case let me come, that means in that case you just see here the direction of magnetic field, here it is like this. Now in this case the plane of the coil is perpendicular to magnetic field. See, this is the plane of the coil, okay, for this plane of the coil magnetic field is perpendicular. Suppose when the coil has rotated like this, now just see, when the coil has rotated like this, right, in this case, now this is the plane of the coil. For this plane of the coil, magnetic field direction is perpendicular. Now you just take these two magnetic field lines. E magnetic field line you just take. Now in that case, this is nothing but plane of the coil. For this plane of the coil, magnetic field is perpendicular. That means whenever you take a concave shaped poles, between the poles, if you take a soft iron, that soft iron is produces the, okay, magnetic field. That magnetic field is always perpendicular to the plane of the coil. Always perpendicular to the plane of the coil. Such magnetic field is called here, this magnetic field is called here, radial magnetic field. Radial magnetic field. That means whenever the soft iron or ferromagnetic material has placed in between the two north and south poles of concave shaped magnets, then what we can get means, okay, those two poles produces the what type of field means? Radial magnetic field. Radial magnetic field means in that field always magnetic field direction is normal to the plane of the coil or magnetic dipole momentum of the coil. That's why here in moving coil galvanometer we should not take here north and south poles as a bar magnets, but we have to take as a conclusion. But these two also we should not take like this one. Actually these are like this are there, but we should not take. We should take like this. Like this we should take. Like this we should take. Horizontally we have to take concussion, not vertically. It is there like this. This is wrong. Actually we have to take like this. Yes, I will show on the board just now. Right? Right, you are observing here moving coil galvanometer arrangement in which these two are north and south poles. In between these two, magnetic field is there. Within this magnetic field, see here I am going to take one coil. This coil is having some number of turns. See around which some number of turns I have mentioned with this. And thereafter, one end of this coil has hung by the torsional head by means of a wire. This wire is nothing but here phosphorus branch wire. Phosphorus branch wire. Right. Now thereafter, this torsional head is connected to the T2 terminal and the lower end of the coil has connected to the T1 terminal. Now thereafter, in between these two poles, what type of field has to be produced means the field is nothing but radial magnetic field. What is the use of radial magnetic field? Radial magnetic field, with the radial in the condition of radial magnetic field, the angle between the magnetic dipole momentum of current carrying coil and magnetic field, both are perpendicular to each other, normal to each other. Now thereafter, see, now to produce this magnetic radial magnetic field here inside this coil, what we have to place means we have to place a material. The name of the material is nothing but here soft iron. Here just see, one soft iron cylinder has placed inside this coil to produce the what type of field means radial magnetic field. You are observing, right? Here I am mentioning. Now this is a cylinder. This cylinder is nothing but here. What type of cylinder means? Soft iron. Now this is a soft iron. Cylinder. Now this is nothing but here coil. Now this is nothing but coil. Current carrying coil. Now these two are nothing but concave shaped magnetic poles. Now whenever in this one, whenever you have connected to the battery. Now in this one, what happens means current will be produced. Current will be flows through the coils, by means of these number of turns. Whatever the number of turns are available in the coil, in all those number of copper winding turns, current will be flows. Whenever the current carrying coil has placed within the magnetic field, now immediately that coil is experiencing the torque. That means the coil is undergoes, this coil is undergoes deflection like this. That means deflection like this. So what is the deflecting torque on the coil means deflecting torque or deflecting torque or couple also we can call. Now the deflecting torque, torque experienced by the coil. Deflecting torque means tau D. Of course, I am taking deflecting torque tau D is equal to torque equal to what is formula? Torque equal to, here I have written, torque equal to MD sine theta. But here MD sine theta, here only I am taking torque is equal to MB sine theta. But here, due to the radial magnetic field, always the angle between the magnetic dipole moment and magnetic field is 90 degree. So sine 90 is equal to 0,
sin 90 equal to 1, because of this reason torque equal to what we can write, mb. Torque equal to mb. Of course this torque is not only by the single turn of the coil. How many number of turns are there? N number of turns are there. So n is nothing but number of turns on the coil. Next, deflecting torque, comma tau p, tau d is equal to n number of turns into magnetic dipole moment. Magnetic dipole moment formula is nothing but the product of current into area. Right? The current which is flowing through the coil is nothing but I. The area of the coil is nothing but A into what we can write, B we can. In bracket, you have to mention here there is nothing but, okay, magnetic dipole moment, M is equal to the product of current into area of the coil. Okay. Now, that means here whenever the coil is turned like this, coil is turned like this, literally. When the coil is turned like this or experience deflecting like this, immediately at the knot point, at the torsion head point, okay, that means in this wire, phosphorus bronze wire, we can see there is a small twist. We can see there is a small twist. Twist can be exist at this point. Is it? Now, what is the function of that twist point means? The twist point means the function of the twist point is nothing but, okay, which bring back the original position to this coil. Actually, coil has rotated like this for the given current I. Okay, suppose if you remove the current from the coil, once again, coil has to come its original position. Now, coil has to come its original position means, okay, what is required? Okay, according to the Newton's law. Right, what happened? If the torque is rotated, if the for a current I, if the coil has turned like this, on removing the current, once again the coil has to come restore means come back to original position. If the coil has to restore its original position means, okay, the twist or torsional torque or restoring torque experienced by the coil means, okay, you just see. Restoring torque. Restoring torque means, okay, tau r. What I can write? Tau r is directly proportional to theta.
Is it?
Right, theta means
the angle through which coil has rotated
by the deflection. Is it? Now, in this case, restoring torque, comma tau equal to, we can write, now from this one, tau r, restoring torque is equal to C into theta, we can, where C is proportionality constant, which is also called, okay, couple per twist, right, where C is couple per unit twist.
Right, now thereafter, that means here, whenever you give the current here, now initially for a small current, you can see small turning, for a large current, turning also large, right? If the current, by giving the some current, without varying the current, if you give some current, now in the case, when the initially coil is there like this, immediately it is rotated like this. Alright, by rotating, okay, it can be here itself. In the case, rotating torque is, that means deflecting torque is in one direction, restoring torque is on another direction. That means both these two torques are equal in magnitude, opposite in direction. That means at the equilibrium position, restoring torque on the coil is equal to deflecting torque. That means deflecting torque is equal to restoring torque or couple, whatever we can call. Right, what is this one? Deflecting torque, NIAP, and this one is nothing but C into theta. Now from this one, I is equal to,
the current which we have given to this current, the current which we have given through this coil for a deflection theta is what I can write? I can write n C divided by n A B into theta. Now this is nothing but current which is flowing through the galvanometer, moving coil galvanometer. That means in moving coil galvanometer, how to measure the current means like this we can measure the current. What are the usual terms or terms meaning? C is nothing but couple per unit dish, that is the constant for a given one. Constant for given Y. That means phosphorus bronze one. Constant for the given Y. Next, N is nothing but number of turns on the coil. Next, A is nothing but area of the coil. B is nothing but magnetic field in the coil. That means these all are constant. So, I is equal to what I can write? K into theta, shall I write? Right. Where? Since. Okay. K is equal to C N A B. Like this. Right. Now from this one, I is directly proportional to what I can write? I is directly proportional to I can write here. Okay. Theta. That means if the current giving through this coil is increases, obviously turn effect also increases. Now this is about the moving coil galvanometer. By using this moving coil galvanometer, we can measure here, what we can measure? Current which is flowing through the coil. By moving coil galvanometer, whatever the current is flowing, how much current is flowing given, okay, can be measured. Is it? Now, from equation 1 once again, still I am going to little bit extend the topic. Okay, from equation 1, I divided by x1. From equation 1, theta divided by I if you take. Theta divided by I if you take means from equation 1. From equation 1 here. If I will bring this side, this complete terms bring this side. This complete term from this side means that is N A B divided by C. N A B divided by C equal to theta divided by I. We can theta divided by I. Theta is nothing but deflection. I is nothing but current. Deflection per current. That means for a given current, how much deflection is okay deflecting by this coil. To tell this one, here we are having theta by I. That means this theta by I is called here, theta divided by I is called here, is current sensitivity. It's called here current sensitivity. Current sensitivity. Or it is also called, okay, figure of merit of galvanometer. Figure of merit of galvanometer. Figure of merit of current sensitivity or figure of merit of galvanometer. What is the figure of merit of galvanometer? What is the current sensitivity? Means the deflection per current. That means for a given current, how much deflection is given by the meter is said to be here current sensitivity. Right. Its unit is theta by I. Unit is, what is the unit of current sensitivity? Okay, for theta, that is nothing but division divided by ampere. Division per ampere is nothing but unit for current sensitivity. Is it? Sir, here current sensitivity we have written. Then what about the voltage sensitivity? That means voltmeter also, it is depends upon this one only. Okay, same explanation. That means to measure the voltage. Right, voltage, suppose if you want to measure here, means you just see theta divided by I is there here. For this I, both sides you divide with 1 by R. Then what I may get here? N A B divided by R C into 1 divided by R should be. So theta divided by I into R. V is equal to what is formula? Voltage is equal to what is formula? current into resistance. So V into NAB divided by C into what we can write here? We can write here R. So this is nothing but here voltage sensitivity. That means this theta by V is nothing but what we can call it as theta by V is called as theta by V is voltage sensitivity. Voltage sensitivity is nothing but deflection per voltage. Voltage sensitivity. Sensitivity. Suppose current is sensitive. If you have given in the meter 1 ampere current you have given. For 1 ampere the deflection is 30 degree. Okay. For 2 ampere the deflection is nothing but 60 degree. 60 degree. Right. Next two. For 3 ampere the deflection is 90 degree means 90 degree. That means in first case we have seen like this. In second case how means for 1 ampere the deflection is 5 or 3 degrees. For 2 amperes the deflection is 6 degrees. Okay. Next for 3 amperes the deflection is nothing but 9 degrees.
1 ampere 3 degree, 2 ampere 6 degree, 3 ampere 9 degree. If the deflection is like this, that means for 1 ampere in first case, galvanometer is rotating to 30 degree. But here for 1 ampere it is rotating only 3 degree. That means for current in first case, the galvanometer is very sensitive. In second case, for current, the galvanometer is less sensitive. That means to produce the small deflection, that means you have to produce the more amount of, you have to give the more amount of current to the meter. Is it? Right. In this case, if you give 1 ampere, the deflection is small. If you give same current, deflection is small. So, in second case, first case, the meter is very sensitive to current, and the second case, the meter is very not sensitive to, this is about the current sensitivity and voltage sensitivity. Here you just see this current sensitivity is also known as figure of merit of galvanometer. Figure of merit of galvanometer, one of the experiment is there in your practicals and PUC. There you can study still very much about this. Right now this is about the moving coil galvanometer. In this moving coil galvanometer, how to measure the current means current can be measured by using moving coil galvanometer like this. If the current is increases to the coil, deflection produced in the coil also increases like this. Now this one is nothing but theta by deflection per current. That means define the current sensitivity. They may ask question like this. Current sensitivity is nothing but deflection per unit current. Deflection per unit current. Yes. Now this is the important concept. Ma, listen to me. Now you listen very clearly explanation part here. Yes. Now see here. Ma. After having moving coil galvanometer, actually moving coil galvanometer is a old version. Right, after moving coil galvanometer, there is a development in galvanometers. Right, portable galvanometer has, that means stable galvanometer has invented. What is the difference between moving coil galvanometer and portable galvanometer? Means moving coil galvanometer is huge in size. But portable galvanometer is light in size. That means very small in size. Moving coil galvanometer cannot be take it from one place to another place. It is difficult. But pointer galvanometer or table galvanometer or portable galvanometer is easy to carry from one place to another place by your single hand. Is it? Next to the measuring the current also difficult in moving coil galvanometer. That means lamp scale method can be used to measure the current in galvanometer. But in table galvanometer, that means portable galvanometer, it is very easy to measure the current.
That's why instead of moving coil galvanometer, nowadays we are using portable galvanometer, point galvanometer or table galvanometer. Pointer galvanometer it is suitable. Right, thereafter our topic is, there are two topics are there. Conversion of galvanometer into ammeter, conversion of galvanometer into voltmeter. Actually galvanometer it is a device used to measure the current. Is it? You just see, this is a current. This is a current carrying conductor. In this current carrying conductor, how much current is flowing? 2 amperes current is flowing. How much? 2 amperes current is flowing. Suppose in the path of this conductor, if you see there is a galvanometer. If you see there is a connection of galvanometer. In that case, what happens means the current flowing through this conductor has measured by 1.8 amperes. That means before connecting the galvanometer, the current flowing through this one 2 amperes. Current flowing through this wire is nothing but 2 amperes. After connecting the galvanometer, the current is nothing but 1.8 amperes. When the current is flowing through the conductor has reduced due to the resistance. Is it? That means here we are getting only 1.8 amperes current here after connecting this galvanometer. Means why? Because means this galvanometer is offering a resistance. Galvanometer is offering the resistance. What is the resistance of galvanometer? It's nothing but GV. Now, this resistance, if you want to reduce, means what you have to do? What you have to do? You have to get the accurate current 2 amperes. Means, okay, this resistance we have to minimize. Minimize. That's why only while you are measuring, okay, current. Okay, you have to select the meter, that meter has low resistance. If the meter has low resistance, obviously measuring current is accurate. It will become accurate. Right here, to minimize this resistance, this galvanometer, whatever the galvanometer is offering here resistance, that resistance we have to minimize. When the resistance is minimized, resistance can be minimized by some other resistance. Is it? Suppose if you connect some another resistance here in series, means this resistance and this resistance. If the resistances are in series, okay, the value of resistance, effective resistance value will become more. So we are not connect the resistance in series. Okay, to this galvanometer in parallel, if you connect some other resistance value, then what happens means the effective current once again it will become 2 amperes. That means, what is the resistance we have to connect in parallel with this galvanometer to get the accurate current means, okay, that resistance is called here, what is that, shunt resistance. That means, here, how we can convert the galvanometer into, okay, ammeter. Galvanometer can be converted into the ammeter by connecting a small resistance in parallel with galvanometer. So here I have given a statement here, you just look at it. Right, what I have given means, a galvanometer can be converted into the ammeter. See, a galvanometer can be converted into the ammeter. When it is converted into the ammeter, by connecting small resistance. That small resistance is nothing but shunt resistance. Small resistance connected parallel to it. That means ee galvanometer ke parallel aagi small resistance nu connect maadidaga galvanometer is converted into the ammeter. So you just look at here, what I am doing here means, here I am going today, okay, this is nothing but one current carrying conductor in which initially how much current is flowing, I current is flowing. Here what I have connected here means I have connected one galvanometer. Now see, this is the galvanometer. The galvanometer is offering the resistance is nothing but G. Right, now to this galvanometer in parallel, that means from here in parallel, if you connect a small amount of resistance parallel to it. What is the name of the resistance? The name of the resistance is nothing but here, yes resistance we have.
In this case, what happened means this complete arrangement of galvanometer. Just see this complete arrangement. Whenever the galvanometer is connected, small resistance in parallel with it, then this complete portion will becomes here ammeter. See, this complete portion will becomes whatever the dotted lines I have shown. Okay, this within the dotted line portion will becomes ammeter. This portion will becomes ammeter. Right? Now it is. That means galvanometer can be converted into the ammeter by connecting small resistance parallel to the galvanometer. Right? Next, thereafter, if you see, whenever I current is reached to this point, at this point, this current is divided into two parts. The current which is flowing through the galvanometer is called here current through the galvanometer. The remaining current which is flowing through the resistance, that means totally how much current is flowing? I current has given here. In this I current, Ig is subtracting. So the remaining current is nothing but I minus Ig is nothing but flowing through this, okay, resistance. Totally here two points are there. In between these two points, that means these two resistances are G resistance and resistance. Both are connected to which one? Ma? Same common points. So potential across these two resistors are same from the parallel combination of resistor. Right? Now, what is the amount of resistance we have to connect in order to convert the given galvanometer into ammeter? This galvanometer has to convert it into the ammeter. What is the amount of resistance we have to connect it to the galvanometer in series? Sorry, parallel. Okay, we have to calculate. Now to calculate this one, okay, from the figure, we have to derive the formula of a shunt resistance, or okay, the resistance which is connected parallel with galvanometer. Right? From the figure, if you just see, all I can write from the figure, right? Potential through the galvanometer is equal to potential through the center resistance. Why? Because both are okay connected to common points. Now from this one, potential through the galvanometer. Actually, potential. What is the potential? Okay, potential V is equal to current into resistance. What is the potential here? Means current into resistance. Current is nothing but Ig into G. Ig current through the galvanometer into resistance of the galvanometer is equal to. Now what is the potential across the shunt resistance? Is nothing but current into resistance. What is the current through the resistance? That is nothing but I minus Ig into S. Suppose I want only S. S is equal to, now what I can write? S is equal to remaining part is, now Ig divided by, this one will come this side, I minus Ig into G. We can, now this is nothing but center resistance. Right? Now what is the resistance which we have to connect to convert this given galvanometer into ammeter? Means this much resistance we have to connect. That resistance is equivalent to this. Right? Now before going to this, okay, right, we have connected here galvanometer into ammeter. Now let me know few points about the okay ammeter. Actually, ammeter has low resistance. Ammeter has low resistance. Is it? Now you don't write after this derivation. You don't write this last. You write after having this one also. Right? Next, second one. Ammeter has low resistance. Right? Ideal ammeter. Ideal ammeter has okay zero resistance. Sir, ammeter has low resistance. Why ammeter has low resistance? To measure the current accurately. Okay, while it is measuring the current accurately, it must have the low resistance. Is it?
Right, next one.
Suppose, sir, very good ammeter. Ideal means very good ammeter. Very good ammeter means, of course, it is having very less resistance. Very less resistance is nothing but zero. So for ideal, resistance is zero.
Next, ammeter used to measure the current. Used to measure the current. It is used to measure the current. Okay,
sir. Ammeter always connected
in series. Always connected in series in circuits. If you take any electrical circuits,
in electrical circuit, ammeter always connected in series. See, now these are all the important points. Right, ammeter has no resistance. Ideal ammeter has zero resistance. Right, ammeter is always connected in series electrical circuits. Okay, remember this. Now come to the point of here. Right, conversion of galvanometer into voltmeter.
Sir, if the galvanometer has to convert it into the ammeter, means we have to connect the small resistance
in that.
But if you want to convert the given galvanometer into voltmeter, if you want to convert the given galvanometer into voltmeter, then you have to connect the large amount of resistance series with the galvanometer.
You just see, now this is nothing but one conductor. Here one galvanometer has connected to this galvanometer. If you connected here large amount of resistance, the name of the resistance is nothing but R. Then the portion of this part will become voltmeter. Is it? By connecting a high resistance, this is the high resistance, in series with the galvanometer, given galvanometer is converted into the voltmeter. What is the current we are giving here? The current we are giving here is nothing but I. That means current we are giving is nothing but IG. Current is flowing here. That means what is the range of this voltmeter? That means this complete portion will becomes behaves like a voltmeter. So what is the range of voltmeter? Range of voltmeter is equal to V is equal to, you just see here what I can write, voltage equal to, what is formula? Voltage equal to current into resistance. Current, what current is there here? Okay, galvanometer current is there. Galvanometer current into what is the resistance? Both are connected in series. If the two resistances are connected in series, means they are going to add up, G plus, what I can write. Now if you send, okay, IG in this side, V divided by IG equal to, we can write G plus R. Now from this one, R is equal to, this G will come this side, means V divided by IG minus, what we can write, G. Now whether you are observing or not, okay, what is the amount of large resistance has to connect in series with galvanometer in order to convert the given galvanometer into voltmeter, means R equal to V by IG minus G. V is voltage range. IG is nothing but, okay, current through the galvanometer. G is nothing but resistance of this given galvanometer. Right? Now thereafter, here about the ammeter, few points I have explained here. Right? What are those? Ammeter has, okay, low resistance. In similar way, how to connect the voltmeter? Okay, voltmeter, about the voltmeter also we have to know few things. Right, now this ammeter and voltmeter explanation you write last. After having this explanation and after having this explanation, you write differences between ammeter and voltmeter. By putting the heading, you write. Of course, I am giving the same notes also. In notes also, I am giving the same. In voltmeter, see, ammeter is having low resistance, but voltmeter is having high resistance. Voltmeter has high resistance. This is the first point. Second point is, ideal voltmeter,
ideal voltmeter has high in high, very high means very high, very high, very high, very high means infinity. Ideal voltmeter has infinity resistance. Right? Next, what is the use of voltmeter? Voltmeter is used to measure the voltage. Right? Used to measure the voltage. Right. Next one. Where we can connect the voltmeter? Voltmeter is always connecting the circuits parallel. Okay. Always connected in parallel. In the circuits, right? Always connected in parallel in the circuits, right? Now these are the important points, right? Now ideal voltmeter has infinity resistance. Voltmeter has high resistance, right? Now these two concepts are important one. We are going to regularly ask in examination. Yes. Right. Our theory of this chapter has completed. In next class, within two video classes, I am going to complete the problems also. So fourth chapter also we are going to finish within this. Or thereafter we are having another two chapters only left, which are nothing but magnetism and matter, electromagnetic induction. Of course, in magnetism and matter, okay, most of this syllabus has deleted very recently. So that topic also we are going to finish one 4 to 5 video classes. See. That's why students, dear students, as much as possible, you just watch the video classes. Don't lose your time. We don't know what is going to happen. Okay? We don't get sufficient time. So these classes you must be utilize yourself. Right? Thank you.